Originalmente soy de San Miguel de Allende, México. Me vine a los Estados Unidos a estudiar ingeniería y he ya arrancado bastantes compañías con la idea de que en el futuro vamos a tener que trabajar muy cercamente con las máquinas. Las máquinas nos van a ayudar a hacer mejores decisiones, competir mejor. Y esta plática la voy a hacer en inglés, así que si tienen cualquier pregunta, con confianza en español, pero los temas los voy a platicar en inglés. Okay, so why does Molecula exist? Molecula is the name of the company that I'm running today. And we're really born out of three predictions. Features, not data, are going to power the entire machine learning lifecycle. I don't know how many people here today know what a feature is. It's not a capability. A feature is essentially an attribute. So data scientists, machine learning engineers for decades have been extracting features from data in order to analyze it on a machine scale. And so features are essentially an attribute about an object. We believe that features are much better for powering machine learning than data itself, and we're going to walk you through what that means. We also believe that companies are going to suffer from data engineering scarcity. There's a lot of talk about data sciences and data scientists being scarce, but we actually believe that it's the data engineer that's going to be the real bottleneck to the future of AI and machine learning. And then lastly, we believe that executives are going to struggle to find use cases to generate ROI from AI and machine learning. So today, every CEO, every company wants to do AI. But the reality is it's very difficult to put AI in production in order to really generate value from the data that's underneath. And so our mission as a company is to make features, as we discussed, these machine-specific attributes, the foundation of AI. And so Molecula itself is what we call an operational AI company that enables businesses to deploy advanced analytics and AI in their applications through a new data format that we invented called a feature storage platform. And so what is a feature storage platform? Well, we believe that a feature storage platform is the evolution of data storage, specifically designed for machine learning. So we have 9 US patents on this technology, and we're working on 24 new patents. And the technology is simple, right? In the 1970s, we started putting information in databases. All of those workloads were very transactional, right? So OLTP-type transactions, single record lookups. And they were very fast at doing that. Very soon thereafter, in the late 70s, we started wanting to analyze the data that was in these databases. And so we started inventing ways to analyze information. So we would make indices, OLAP cubes. Today, we're calling it columnar databases. And this is when the real explosion in data started in the world. I think it's a little-known fact that only about 15% of data today is original. The other 85% of data is copies that we make in order to analyze and extract value in our analytical and machine learning workloads. So columnar databases have been great, but they're not really solving for the machine-scale use cases, and they're leading us to copies upon copies of the data. So 7 years ago, we invented a feature format that we're calling feature-based. This feature-specific, value-specific-based format stores and retrieves data at the value. So instead of having to scan an entire row in a query or scan an entire column in a query, you're literally reading and writing at the format. And further, because this format is so unbelievably efficient, the data is usually 10-20 times smaller in footprint, and it's 10-20 times smaller across the network than operating on actual data. Additionally, this format is so computationally effective that it's orders of magnitude faster than operating on data. And speed is great, right? We all want to do things faster. But the reality is that speed on its own is not a killer feature. What speed really does in this feature-oriented format is open up the opportunity to transform data at the query and in your models instead of having to do it in your infrastructure. It opens up the ability to query data and join that data at the query instead of in infrastructure ahead of time through pre-processing and pre-aggregation. Also, the feature store can answer any question about the underlying data without having to go to the original data stores. So we think it's going to be features, not data, that power the entire machine learning lifecycle. And none of this is new, right? Feature engineering is the process to prepare data for machine scale analysis, and feature extraction is the very first step where we're converting data into features. Well, what we have done as a company is we've automated this so that we automatically take data sources like, you know, traditional databases, object stores, and we convert those to features and store them in this purpose-built feature store. And underneath the hood, these features simply look like bitmaps, right? So in one direction, we have objects. In the other direction, we have attributes. And we're simply storing the intersections where the objects and the attributes are intersecting. These intersections are simply represented by a binary flip. And this format is incredibly compressible. So we apply homomorphic compression to these bitmaps, and we distribute them and shard them in clusters so that now when you're running a query against a very large data set or a very large streaming data set, you're actually getting unbelievably fast response times. And again, features aren't new. This is something that we've been doing for a very long time. But most of the feature extraction world is thinking feature last. We believe that the world is going to start thinking feature first, and we're going to start putting features at the beginning of our process, not at the end of our process. And why is this such an important topic? Well, companies today are going to have to compete with their data. Access to data and AI should be available to every company in every geography. But the reality is that it's the very well-funded startups and the tech giants like Amazon, Google, and Facebook that are investing hundreds of millions of dollars each into data and AI to develop new products. And if we're not careful, these companies are going to own every business in the world. And so I'm obsessed personally with making sure that access to these technologies are available to everyone. And I think that this is much more of a data problem than it is an AI and machine learning problem. And so why is it that real-time data is so hard? Well, I believe it's because today's architectures are riddled with batch processing. So every type of data has a different type of database. Since we have to pre-process and pre-aggregate data, we're putting things in what I call the Hadoop zoo or the Hadoop soup. And things like customers, products, which are your most important data, are sitting scattered throughout your company. The average US Fortune 500 company has customer data in over 500 databases. So getting an up-to-the-moment view of all of your data in real time is incredibly difficult. If speed and latency aren't important, no problem. You can solve the human scale issues using these infrastructures. They're expensive and complicated, but they will power BI and reporting. But if you want to do real-time analytics in your applications, if you want to power, you know, production machine learning, it's going to be very difficult by making copies and pre-aggregating and pre-processing data. So we think an entirely new generation of technology is required. So pre-aggregation, we talked about, right? In order to use data today, you have to pre-process it if you want it to be fast. Things like IoT, sensors generating lots of data at the edge. That sensor data is very simple. It contains a serial number, a timestamp, and a measurement. But those aren't enough to make a decision. So guess what? We have to move all of that data back to the data centers, and we have to pre-aggregate it with the supply chain data and the customer data and the inventory data. And then and only then can we make predictions about how a particular failure in a supply chain might affect revenue or might affect our customers. And that process can take days, sometimes weeks, absolutely eliminating the process of making real-time decisions at the edge. Federation is also a true and tried technique. Let's send queries down to all of the systems and stitch them back together. That's okay if you don't need to do complex joins. That's okay if you can wait minutes or hours for those queries to return. But if you need real time, Federation is not going to do it. And then we're seeing a lot of innovation around brute force, right? Even the biggest storage clouds in the world are automating the pre-processing and pre-aggregation of data. So there's a lot of DevOps that's going into the automation of a lot of these processes. We're also throwing in-memory systems and GPUs and FPGAs at the problem, but this just makes it all that much more expensive. So we can't do this for all of our data. But we think features, when we convert data to features at the beginning of the machine learning lifecycle, it changes everything. All of a sudden, we can have all of our data in a state where if we need to use it, it is instantly available. And so we believe the problem today is really that we're putting our AI machine learning cart before our data readiness horse. And as a result, only 6% of machine learning models are making it to production. It costs $2 to $3 million to productionize a single machine learning model or AI model. And the process can take 9 to 12 months at best. So this is not going to get us very far. So we think that features are really the path to solving this data readiness problem, right? With features, you can make your data ML ready, and you can deliver a format to consistently power all of your advanced analytics and machine learning projects. And so for us, speed and performance is the number one benefit from operating on features instead of data. Ultra low latency, highly performant, model ready data is what you expect from features versus data. Also simplified access and 360s, like I was saying earlier. Access to customer data and patient data and device data is very difficult. And so being able to see your customer data all in one place instantly and being able to run ultra low latency queries or iterative queries against that is incredibly important for us to move forward. So 360s are definitely one of the main value propositions of using features instead of data. And then I think most importantly, cost and simplicity is a huge piece of moving forward. All of these copies that I talk about, when we make copies of data in order to pre-process it and prepare it for analysis, that undertakes architecture and deployment and security and monitoring. Every single one of those copies is costing us. And most importantly, it's costing us time. It's leading to batch processes and latency. And we're never going to get out of what I call the data death spiral unless we take a totally different approach. So I believe that we're in the process of going from human scale workloads to machine scale workloads. I believe that the world is now starting to demand the movement out of the use cases that we're used to seeing, like descriptive and diagnostic analytics, and into predictive and prescriptive and proactive analytics, right? So, you know, what is descriptive and diagnostic? We all know those, right? It's BI and reporting. Descriptive is, you know, your typical pie chart or your typical bar chart. You know, diagnostic is supposed to be insights. We've lived a really interesting last decade of quote unquote having insights. I still don't believe we've really seen the value of insights. I don't wake up every day with an email that tells me all the things that I need to do in that day. I do look forward to that day. But we're starting to move into trying to make predictions and prescriptions. In fact, I think I accidentally skipped this slide. Yeah, exactly. So we're trying to move into this realm of predictive and prescriptive and proactive analytics, but we can't do that with batch updates and batch processes. The size of the data that we're processing out of our event streams are in the tens of millions, hundreds of millions, billions, hundreds of billions of events a day. And we're having to combine that with historical data sets to make these predictions in that moment. And we just can't do it with that existing infrastructure. And prescriptive analytics are gonna also be fascinating, right? Like, I predict what's gonna happen, and now let's prescribe an action that we need to take on that prediction. Again, we can't do that after the fact. We have to do it in that moment. And so we need a new infrastructure to be able to do all of that. And then I think one of the most exciting form of analytics that's coming at us as a world is proactive, right? How do we take an action automatically based on a prediction and the choices that we have in terms of the action that we need to take? And then how do we incorporate a feedback loop so every time that proactive action happens, we can learn and the system can refine itself? This is where we're all going. This is how we're going to reinvent industries like healthcare and life sciences and agriculture. And I believe that this is going to drive a super evolution. We're starting to see things move faster and faster. But again, it's happening in these top few companies. It's happening in the Netflixes and Googles of the world. I don't know how many of you have watched the movie, the documentary on Netflix called Social Dilemma. you know, it talks about what is happening inside of these social networks and how these algorithms are driving behaviors in societies. Well, that is real. And that is happening at a scale that we have a hard time explaining. And to me, those are super evolutionary sparks. But what happens when we apply that technology to problems that really impact our lives, that impact our health, that impact our food systems and supply chains? I think some amazing things happen. So as we think about the future, we're going to start moving from these storage clouds, you know, take the Snowflakes and the Amazons and the Googles. They've created compute environments that are based on data to help us solve our human scale problems, to compute clouds where we're really going to be loading models, not worrying about the data. Those models are going to operate on features instead of data. And we're going to be making decisions at the speed of thought. These operational AI infrastructures, I believe, are going to be managed by the data engineers. I think the data scientists are going to be the users and the consumers, those that are extracting the value. But it's the data engineers that are going to be responsible for ushering in this future. So we need to decide, each one individually, us as companies, do we want to go do AI for the sake of doing AI? Or do we really want to build a foundation so that we can build value for our company, so that we can create scalable processes that allow us to compete against the titans, or allow us to compete against the very well-funded startups? And I'm making the assertion today, and I look forward to your feedback, that this is about operating on features instead of data. Data was for humans, features are for machines.